大家好，我是 Eric 张万年。 Making Murder 是 Netflix 出品的一个非常出名的一个纪录片，相信有很多的朋友都看过，给没看过的朋友稍微的介绍一下吧。一个叫做 Stephen Avery 的人来自一个比较混乱的家族，他智力很低，据说就70左右。在1985年的时候， Stephen 据说是性侵了一名女性，被判入狱了32年，在18年后被证明但是他是无辜的，于是被释放了。人出来之后呢，在专业的翻案律师和组织的帮助之下，跟当地的政府和警局去开战，揭露出当地执法部门的诸多的问题，并且要求巨额的赔偿。此事当时闹的动静是非常的大，搞得这个当地政府啊和警局啊都灰头土脑的。仅仅的在被释放2年之后，那个时候 Stephen 还正在为自己的这个18年冤狱抗争的时候，他再一次因为性侵和谋杀的罪名又被逮捕了。这一次被一起逮捕的还有他同样智力低下的这个侄子 Brandon Dassey， 两人再一次的被成功定罪并且入狱。可以预见的是啊，这次事情又一次引来了大量的关注和全美媒体的争相报道。不过经过 Netflix 这个纪录片的分析呢，这个事情呢是大有蹊跷的。在这个案件的调查过程中，因为 Stephen 和当地的政府和警局的这个历史问题，上面其实是派遣了其他的警局和部门负责这个案件的，而本来应该因为利益冲突而保持距离的当地警局呢，却非常积极地参与到了这个案件的侦破中间，而且屡建奇功，找到了很多其他部门都没有找到的关键证物。最后定罪的一个非常关键的证据，就是 Stephen 那个智力低下的侄子，据说在警察的审讯中被突破了，招供了 Stephen 确实是奸杀了那个叫做 Teresa Halbach 的这个女摄影师啊，并且自己呢也是有参与的。很多人啊对这个审讯保持强烈的怀疑态度。我想办法找到了这个审讯的完整的无删减的视频，事实到底是怎么样子，我们一起来看看。
Absolutely.
Let's see it.
I just have a seat, Brendan.
现在坐在沙发上的这个就是 Brandon Dassey 啊 ，Stephen 的侄子，当时呢只有16岁，智力低下 ，IQ 只有74。他现在啊是一个高中生，在一个特殊教育的这个班级上课，成绩很差，屡屡挂科。学校的心理学家对他的评估上写着啊，他有学习障碍，有语言障碍和自我表达的障碍。刚进来的时候，他双手都是插在裤子口袋里面，把手藏起来，显示出这个环境啊，他很不舒服。随后警察出去，他一个人坐着的时候，他是一只手拿起来，先是一个指头伸在嘴里面，这样子显示出有不安全感。这个不安全感呢，应该是环境带来的。于是下一个动作的手呢，就放在嘴巴附近，眼睛呢也是在周边看来看去，显示出对于这个周边的环境呢有强烈的探索，有好奇心。在后面50倍快进的这个部分呢，我们可以看到他的手主要还是在嘴巴的这个附近活动的，总体呢还是一个不安全感的一个表现。不过他的坐姿是比较 lay back 的，他是靠在这个椅子上，并没有很紧张。可以说总体上是一个心态很好的人被放在一个陌生环境下的一个自然的一个状态。
How you doing, buddy? Good. Brendan, here you go. I'm just going to shut this audio off, okay? Because there's audio in the room here. Just so you know. I just wanted to just go over this real quick again. You remember these rights, your Miranda rights that I read you? You still want to talk to us?
Yeah.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure of that.
Brendan, I want you to
宣读权利啊，这个非常重要的流程，基本上是被跳过了。根据这两个警察后来写的报告上可以看出啊，他们在开车带 Brendan 来警局的这个路上就已经跟他宣读过权利了。但是标准的流程来讲，你做到审讯之后呢，一定还是要正式的再宣读一遍权利的。对于未成年人来说，应该是有监护人和律师在场才能审问的，这也是为了防止被审问的这个人并不是100%的理解自己的权利。大家不要觉得这个事情多此一举啊，根据 Thomas Grisel 的分析啊，至少有 55.3% 的未成年人是没有办法完全理解米兰达警告的每一条的，而这个数据在成年人中间是 23.1%。 另外很多时候在审讯室里面，人在这个极度无助的情况下会相信警察能够救他们。 Brandon 这里啊，就跟有些英文不太好的华人一样，警察问了什么他都点头说 yes， 也不知道是不是真的懂了，反正他是很轻易的就放弃了自己的米兰达权利。
And I want to assure you that Mark and I bothare in your corner, we're on your side. One of the reasons you hadn't come forward yet was because you were afraid, you're scared, and one of the reasons you were scared was that you would be implicated in this, or people would say that you helped or did this, okay, and that you might get arrested and stuff like that, okay? Stephen is already starting to say some things, And eventually he's going to potentially lay some crap on you and try and make it look like you are the bad person here.
We've been investigating this a long time. We pretty much know everything. That's why we're talking to you again today. You get home off the bus at about 3:45.
Yeah.
And what do you do? Now you got to be honest here.
I walked on my way and I go into my house. Yeah.
What did you see at that time?
That she was talking, or her car was over there.
So then, did what happen? And you saw her and him on the porch, and they were what?
They were talking.
And then what did you do?
I walked in my house. I went into my room, and because my mom told me I had to clean my room, I cleaned it a little bit, and I played PlayStation 2 for a little bit. It was about like 5 o'clock. Then he called and said that he wanted help on his car.
And what does he say to you?
He says, "Do you want to help me with to fix the car?" Because he said that if I would help him on his cars, he would like help me find a car.
Okay.
And so I did.
We talked about cleaning something up in that garage. You told me that you thought, thinking back now, that it was blood, it was red in color.
Brandon 被警察盯上是一个有些巧合的事情。在2005年的11月6号，在警察在 Steven 的这个旧车厂里搜查的第二天，警察看到有两个年轻人开着 Steven 的车，上前一问呢，发现这两个都是 Steven 的侄子。他们说要去开车啊，买饮料喝，其中一个就是咱们现在的这个嫌疑人 Brandon。当天警察对 Brandon 进行了最初的盘问，随后又在2006年的2月27号三次，当天就有三次审问 Brandon。当天的前两次、都是在警局里面，第三次呢比较耐人寻味，警察以安全为由让 Brandon 和他的母亲住在警局旁边的一个酒店里面。那天晚上警察到了他们的房间里面，对他进行了问话，但是这一次问话到底说了什么没人知道。第一次问话在警察执法的时候呢有执法的录音，后两次是在审讯室里面也有录音录像的这个设备，而酒店里面是什么也没有的。等到现在我们看到的这一次3月1号的这个审讯呢，这已经是第五次审问他了。
You're at your house6:30, I'll go that far with you. It might even been earlier. What's going on? Let's take it through honestly now.
Come on, Brandon, be honest. I told you before, that's the only thing that's going to help you here. We already know what happened. Okay?
If we don't get honesty here, I'm your friend right now. But I gotta believe in you. And if I don't believe in you, I can't go to bat for you.
警察现在用的是一个叫做 friendship theme 的一个审讯方法，警察会假装关心是嫌疑人的朋友啊，只有我关心你，只有我能帮你，但是你要我帮你，你必须要配合我，或者说是按照我说的做。这个审讯方法其实最大的基础问题是不能给嫌疑人做出虚假的承诺，比如说你跟我合作的话，我就会帮你争取宽大的处理，本来该判五年啊，现在我给你判两年，这个在审讯中间的 leniency 是绝对不允许的。
Okay, you nod. Tell us what happened.
Your mom said you'd be honest with us.
She's behind you 100% no matter what happens here.
That's what she said.
警察现在用的是一个叫做 third party authority 这个方法，在这种方法之下呢，警察会劝说嫌疑人说是你的父母啊，你的家人已经批准，已经鼓励你跟我们合作了。这样说有几个点，第一就是增加对方的这个压力，你家人已经知道你在这边了。第二，更重要的是去增加他的孤立感，我们这么做他们已经批准了，没有人来救你，你不跟我们合作的话，你的家人可能会失望，会生气，使得对方觉得如果自己不跟警察合作的话，没有其他的选择了。
She thinks you know more too.
We're in your corner.
We already know what happened. Now tell us exactly. Don't lie.
We can't say it for you, Brandon, okay?
这边呢是 maximization, 是最大化战术。我们什么都知道，我们有足够的证据，这都是让嫌疑人觉得绝望。即使是上了法庭也没有什么机会。我们现在之所以不说呢，是因为我们不能主动替你说出来，我们说出来那叫做诱供，同时也看你呢会不会跟我们说实话。总之就是要给嫌疑人一个感觉，事情会不会更好呢不知道，但是你如果不跟我合作的话，肯定会有更糟糕的结果等着你。
Well, that morning he said that if he wanted me to come over like at 6:30 and he had the fire started, because he wanted to burn some tires.
Mm-hmm.
And so he had it started, and the Jeep was still in there. Her Jeep.
That's right.
Her Jeep was in the garage, wasn't it?
那天的情况是这样的 ，Steven 家是开旧车厂的，他经常会要卖车，而这个受害者 Teresa 呢是一个摄影师，已经很多次被 Steven 雇来给车拍照，然后把这个照片传上网去卖车嘛，打广告。根据 Steven 说 ，Teresa 当天开着自己的这个丰田 RAV4 来拍了照之后，开车就走了。而 Brandon 现在交代的情况是在第二天的早上还看到 Teresa 的车停在 Steven 的车库里，那证明 Teresa 并没有离开。
Where was she?Well, we know this already. Be honest.
In the back of the Jeep?
She was in the back of the Jeep. Was she alive at that time?
Dead.
Are you sure? Okay. What did you see in the back? Now, this is hard, but what did you see in the back of the Jeep?
That she was laying there.With like a small blanket over her.
Did she have clothes on?
Yeah.
She was clothed.
Yeah.
Was she tied up already? Or did you help him do that?
She was tied up already.
Where? Tell me how she was tied up.
Like the rope was right here around her body.
Tell us what he told or asked her to do.
He said, hey, Brandon, you want to help me do something?
And? Keep going.
I said, for what? And he's like, for something to do in my garage.
根据 Brandon 自己说的是第二天早上 Steven 来到他家里，说是车库里的车需要他帮忙叫他的。但这里有一个疑点，就是 Steven 啊，他是一个五大三粗的一个大男人啊，而 Teresa 是一个很瘦弱的女性。如果 Teresa 当天没有离开，第二天早上还出现在车库里面，出现在这个车的后座上面的话，那 Steven 肯定是干什么坏事了，对吧？那他既然干了坏事，为什么会找他的侄子来帮忙？为什么还要选择让其他的人知道这个事情？这个侄子确实是智力低下，身体又强壮，貌似是一个帮忙的不错的一个人选，但是毕竟是个小女孩而已嘛， Steven 是没有必要让他的侄子去参与进来这个事情的。
I said, sure, and then...
So you see her Jeep, and then what happens? Does he... what?
He opens the back door.
Okay, and what does he say?
And told me to help him.
Don't you ask him a question, who is this, or what?
Yeah.
Okay, tell me what he said.
He said that it's a girl that... you...was kind of peed off at.
Brandon 这里说话的节奏呢有变化，这是一个词儿一个词儿的往外蹦啊，他有点生气。当然，警察前面的这个问题问的确实有点强势，给他的压力可能很大。
Did he say who it was?
Teresa Hallbach.
这不可能 ，Steven 当场绝对不可能直接就跟他说了这个女人的全名啊 ，Teresa Hallbach.
Why was he peed off at?I think he probably told you. So just be honest. We already know.
He's obviously not holding anything back from you. He had you come over to see this.
We already know.
He used you for this. So bring us into the garage again. You mentioned earlier that's when he threatened you. Tell us that.
That he threatened me that...If I would say anything, that he would stab me like he did to her. And
这里有一个非常大的一个问题。前面当警察施压问他，难道你没有问 Steven 这是谁吗？他一开始其实是没有提到这个细节的。但是当警察说了之后呢，他马上就顺着警察的意思去说啊，问了这是 Teresa Hallbach。这是我前面说的，我完全不相信。如果当时 Steven 有跟 Brandon 进行这个谈话的话，他会说这个女人的全名，不可能的。我甚至都不认为他们会进行这个谈话，会问这个问题。你前一天如果看到你的亲戚跟一个美女啊站在家门口，第二天这个美女被你家亲戚啊绑起来放在他的车后座，你的反应会是什么？你会问他，哎，这谁啊叔？ 不可能嘛。所以这里警察有统治他进行服从性测试的嫌疑，而 Brandon 更可能说的是不是当时发生的情况，而是他事后了解到的这个信息，在被强迫的状态下去回答警察的问题。更明显的是下面，警察问 Steven 为什么生他的气， Brandon 说我不知道。对这俩警察来说，不知道不是一个可接受的答案，所以后面吧，看上去真的就是很像警察是故意启发他。你之前不是说 Steven 有威胁你吗？你现在说说这个事儿。然后 Brandon 马上又顺着警察的意思就说，哦，是的，他威胁我，如果我说出去的话就怎么怎么样。警察的目的是为了把 Steven 塑造成一个暴力的一个愤怒的暴力分子，而 Brandon 这些话呢，就是很完美的帮警察了这个忙。而实际上我根本都不明白 Steven 为什么要找 Brandon 过来帮他，完全没有这个必要嘛。你更没有必要把人找过来之后还要去威胁人家，你这自相矛盾。你说 Steven 自己一个人搞不定，你找个人来帮忙，那我理解，我去找一个好吓唬的人过来，然后我威胁他给我帮忙。但是五大三粗的 Steven 很明显根本不需要人帮忙来处理一个小女生，或者你说 Brandon 是无意中撞到，无意中发现他这个事情了，然后 Steven 这种情况之下劝他去威胁他的侄子，那也是有可能的。但是他是主动的去找 Brandon 呢，说自己车库需要帮忙，这里确实听起来就不是那么回事了。我前面说过，这不是他们的第一次谈话，已经审过好几次了，尤其是上一次谈过什么我们还不知道。但是从警察的角度来说，这话确实呢感觉很像是已经在逮捕之后又过了一段时间，在监狱里面再次去问案件的细节的时候才产生的对话。
Okay, so he opens the back door of her truck and tell me what you see.
Her body laying there.
What could you see of her?
Truth now. As hard as it is, tell us the truth
Her head, her body, her feet.
So she was not covered up? No, I didn't think so. See, we already knew that.
Did she have clothes on? To be honest. If she did, she did. If she didn't, she did.
Sort of.
Okay, what'd she have on?
Like a white t-shirt and that. Pants.
What do you mean, sort of?Either she had clothes on or she didn't. It's what, some of it on, some of it off? What?
Well, it was like ripped.
It was ripped? Where was it ripped?
Like right here.
Was it a t-shirt or a button-up shirt or what kind of shirt?
A button-up one.
What color?
Like a black one.
Okay, before you just said there was a white t-shirt, she had that on too?
Mm-hmm.
Underneath that shirt?
Yeah.
Okay. And in the other interview, you said it was blue. Do you remember what color it was? If you don't remember, say you don't remember.
I don't remember.
Brandon 太明显是顺着警察的意思在说了。他犹豫的点很怪。警察问衣服是什么颜色的，他没有出现任何的思考回忆的这个动作或者表情，犹豫了十几秒钟没说话，最后说是黑色的。但是之前他说是白的，在之前他说是蓝的，那到底是什么颜色连他自己可能都不记得了。根据这一点，有一个可能性是在审讯室中有一种现象叫做 false memory， 错误记忆。有些警察在审嫌疑人，尤其是问一些非常特定的点发生的事情的时候，明明这个可能性其实没有发生，但是呢它可能是一个非常合理的一个推论吧。那么警察问嫌疑人当时是不是这样子这样子这样子啊？你告诉我细节到底是怎么样子的。嫌疑人在被警察完全统治的情况下，就有可能会顺着警察的意思去编造出来一些其实根本没有发生的事情，而且往往在说完之后他自己还深信不疑的认为，哎，事实就是这样子。我举个例子吧，就是说是我本来是从一个房间的一楼的客厅里面我偷了一个戒指，但是警察在完全统治我之后，他问我你是不是在那个房间的二楼的卧室里偷了那个戒指，对吧？你告诉我你是怎么那么快的跑上二楼偷了戒指然后再跑回来的。我在这个时候我就可能会质疑自己的记忆，我顺着警察的意思去想，哦，对哦，戒指在二楼在卧室里那更合理，那么我为什么那么快呢？那肯定是门没有锁吧。然后我对警察招供，应该是门没锁，然后我跑得又很快。我说完之后我还觉得这是事实，但是其实这不是，这就有点是那个感觉。尤其他一会儿说是黑色，一会儿是蓝色，一会儿又是白色。总体而言，任何一个嫌疑人当他坐在审讯室里面，他面对的警察的时候，他心中都有一个故事，可能是编造的故事，可能是完全真实的故事。而警察审讯就是通过各种方式去影响他们的这个故事。如果是编造的部分的话，受到影响就会更大，你期望他可以说出真相。但是你影响这个故事的话，也有可能会出现 false memory， 一旦出现的话，如果警察掌握的这个信息，这个情报是有问题的，他们得到的也是一个不准确的信息，并且嫌疑人也被搞得很混乱，他自己也不知道真相到底是什么了。那等于说两边都不知道这个真相是什么了，口供呢就没有意义了。
Where did you see injuries on her?
Her stomach.
Her stomach. What did it look like?
Like she was.
Well, I don't necessarily. I'm gonna tell you. I don't know what it looks like when someone stabbed.Okay, you gotta talk to someone that doesn't realize this. Tell us what you saw.
Like it was all bleeding in there.
Show me where, and I knew that would be.
Like right here.
How much blood? Was that, show me on you the extent of the stain or the blood that you saw.
Like right there.
That whole area, was it pretty wet yet or dry?
跟一只催更的朋友道个歉啊，最近老是飞来飞去的，总在行程中，导致我的这个移动盘竟然突然间给坏掉了，所有的数据都弄没了。那个时候视频已经做了一半了，弄得我重新开始从头来过。移动盘真的太不靠谱了。不过还好，自从我发现 Surfshark VPN 之后，我在网络上的使用啊一直没有遇到任何问题，我可以很安心的在外使用公共的这个 WiFi 上网。他们内建的这个 Clean Web 功能还可以帮我阻挡恶意的软件和网络钓鱼。他们100多个国家有超过3200台的服务器，我走到哪还是网络使用的速度还都不错。最近他们又推出了这个加强版的 Surfshark One 这个4合一的架构套餐，我试了一下还挺靠谱的，尤其是特别喜欢他们自带的这个搜索工具 Surfshark Search， 我可以完全私密的进行网页搜索，不会留下任何的历史痕迹，这样我就可以放心的使用我这个工作的电脑，而不用担心被别人发现什么我私下的一些事情了。推荐大家现在就使用我专属的这个 VPN 链接，或者是输入优惠码 ERICCA 去享受 1.7折的优惠，订购2年的那个方案呢还会免费的再送你3个月，而且还有30天的退货保证。
Tell us exactly what he told you he did to her.
That he ripped off her clothes and she refused and she tried to get away but he went, he was too strong for her. And he did it.
He did what?
I was outside riding my bike. I could hear it.
What could you hear?
Screaming.
Was the door closed at that time?
Mm-hmm.
Did he know you were out there?
No.
What was the screaming like? What was she saying?
Like, help me.
Did you know what was going on?
No.
What did you do?
Well, I was going up to the driveway and get the mail.Well, when I got the mail, it was like a envelope in there with his name on it.
Okay, now we're going. But what did you do?
I knocked on the door and he answered it.
Yeah, and then what?
I gave it to him and then I left.
他在外面听到他叔叔的房间里面有一个陌生的女孩在大叫救命，然后他的反应竟然是去拿信，然后走过来把信给他送过来，然后他就走了。就这不对劲的地方太多了，为什么他要去敲门呢？为什么他敢去敲门呢？他不是先去偷偷的先偷听先去偷看是怎么回事？为什么一定要这个时候去拿信呢？听上去很像是故意的去拿信，然后故意的借故去敲门。那如果是真的送信的话，那就证明他的叔侄关系真的是非同一般。而且说实话，有一个很可怕也很合理的一个推论是，难道这事儿经常发生吗？然后他真的也就是送完信然后他就走了。
You went inside, didn't you?
Yeah.
You went in the trailer?
Mm-hmm.
You're not.
Did he invite you in?
Yeah.
Okay. And where was she?
In his room.
Okay. Did you go back to her and look?
No.
Brandon, be honest.
I didn't.
How do you know she was in his room?
The door was open.
Could you see her?
Yeah.
Was she alive?
Well, she was handcuffed to the thing.
She was handcuffed to what?
The bed.
Was she naked? Was she alive?
Yeah.
How do you know?
Because she was moving around.
Was she making any noise?
Yeah.
What was she saying?
Screaming for help.
You're getting there, okay? Let's back up again. Did you go get the mail?
Yeah.
When you went to get the mail with your bike, did you hear something at that time, or did it happen when you came back with the mail?
I knocked. Wait three times, and then he finally came.
Are you hearing anything coming from the other side of the trailer at this time?
Yeah.
What?
The words help me.
Okay. It's got to be pretty devastating, right? But you still knock.
Mm-hmm.
You went into the trailer then?
You knock and he comes to the door. What's he look like? Is he dressed? Has he got anything on him? What's he look like?
He's got a white shirt on with red shorts and all sweaty.
He's all sweaty. Any blood at this time?
No.
All right.
Does he let you in the trailer?
He lets me in the kitchen.
He what?
He walks me into the kitchen.
What does he say to you?
If I want a soda.
Does he know you've heard anything? Is she still saying stuff?
Yeah. That he wanted to get some.
Some what?
That's what he said to you?
Now I can start believing you. Okay?
So do you have a soda?
Mm-hmm.
And then what happens next?
I open it and drink some.
What's he saying to you?
That he wants to keep on doing it.
Okay.
Doing what?
Yeah.
What kind of words is he using, though?
That he wanted to hurt so hard.
What happens next? Remember, we already know, but we need to hear it from you. It's okay. It's not your fault. What happens next? He asks you, doesn't he? What does he ask you?
Said if I wanted a girlfriend.
Tell us how he said it.
That if he wanted me to get some.
Then what happens next?
They said that if I wanted to, I can go get some, but not right now.
Come on, be honest. You went back into that room.
Don't let us down, Brendan.
We know you were back there.
So he took me back there and showed me some.
What did he show you?
Her naked body.
Okay, is she alive?
Yeah.
What did you do?
What did Steven make you do?
Minimization, maximization 是沈云师常用的一个方法，把严重的事情说得不严重，把不严重的事情都说得很严重。目的呢，也是通过调整嫌疑人心里的这个罪恶感去调整他们的心态，以期他能够招供。这里同时是个更典型的，在沈云师里面叫做 inverted confession。大家可能听说过 reserve psychology 吧，就逆反心理。生活中间，比如说，你谈生意，怎么谈都谈不拢。你可能就会直接跟对方说，算了吧，反正咱们谈怎么谈都不行，干脆到这里停止吧。你越这样，对方反倒有可能会越愿意跟你谈。你追求一个女孩子，你怎么都差一步，那你也可以尝试的对她说，你既然也没有准备好谈恋爱，那干脆啊，我们都停一停，都再考虑考虑吧。你越这样子，反倒对方有想要去说服你去谈恋爱的冲动，这个就叫做 reverse psychology。 而 reverse psychology 在审讯室里面版本就叫做 inverted confession。我知道你并不想这么做，你是没有选择了啊！我知道你不是一个人干的，你被人强迫了，这都是强奸的话术。
He told me to do.
What does that mean to you?
To school.
Did you do that?
All right, take a breath. Take a.
这段视频出现了故障啊，有很明显的跳跃，对吧？跳一次几秒钟的这个片段就没有了。
It's okay. Okay.
Where is Steve at this time? Take a little break.
Yeah, take a breath.
Steven 这一次在审讯室里面的这25分钟跟上一次警察不在自己独自待在审讯室里面的时候，他本质上呢其实没有太大的不同，主要的不同就是上一次他对于环境是有陌生感的，他有好奇的这个感觉，而这一次呢他主要是焦虑。你看拿一瓶水他摆弄了半天。
Hey, Brendan, you need a bathroom or anything? You sure? Need anything else?
Mm-hmm.
Sandwich or anything? Did you get your soda?
Yeah.
Okay. We'll be in about 2 minutes, okay?
I have a question.
Sure.
How long is this going to take?
It shouldn't take a whole lot longer.
Do you think I can get there before 1:29?
Probably not. What's at 1:29?
Well, I have a project 216 going.
Okay. We'll worry about that later, okay? All right. I'll be back in a few minutes, okay?
Okay.
啊，这是一个很大很大的一个问题。 Brandon 竟然觉得自己还能走，而且他还能提前走。 Brandon 很明显是他并不清楚他放弃他的权利选择跟警察去配合去接受审讯说了这些话之后的后果是什么。他说了刚才那些话之后到这里他还觉得自己会没事，一会儿弄完就可以走了。
We went in there, we tied her up andHe stabbed her, and he told me to cut and cut her hair off. And when we were done like that, we took off the handcuffs, and we took her outside to the Jeep, stuck her in the back. He said he would rather burn her thanstick her back in there, and we put her on the floor, and then he shot her 10 times, and he threw her in the fire.
What do you do after you put her on the floor?
And we went out, and he was going to take the Jeep down in the pit, so he did, and that's when we covered it with branches in the hood.
事情到这一步已经很清晰了，警察为了确保让 Brandon 还拿笔去画下来当时的一些画面。
Everybody has a reason for doing things. What was your reason for this?
I wanted to see how it felt.
See how what felt?
Sex.
During this whole thing, did you ever think about trying to stop Steven?
Yeah.
Why didn't you?
That time he would try to, like,try to kill me.
Mark just asked you a little while ago if he ever threatened you. Now, earlier you had said Monday you talked about something like that, and now you said no. What's the truth?
He didn't threaten me. I just thought that he could have, because he's bigger than me, that he could probably beat me up, man.
So are you telling us now?That he never threatened you?
Oh.
And are you admitting to us that you had told us that Monday?
Yeah.
But now you're saying that didn't happen.
Am I going to be at school before school ends?
Probably not. I mean, we're at 2:30 already. And school's over at what, 3?
3:05.
3:05, yeah. No.
What time will this be done?
Well, we're pretty much done. You know, we have a couple of follow-up things to ask you, but it's pretty much done.
Yeah.
We had mentioned here that we'd like to maybe go out to the property so you can point out some of these things and where some of the stuff was. Okay?
Okay.
他到现在还不知道。
Brendan, go ahead. What do you think is going to happen?What do you think should happen right now?
I don't know.
you know, obviously, that we're police officers, okay? And because of what you told us, we're going to have to arrest you. Did you kind of figure that? What's coming? For what you did, we can't let you go right now. The law will not let us. So you're not going to be able to go home tonight. All right?
Does my mom know?
Your mom knows.
Your mom is here, okay? Would you like to talk to her?
Yeah.
Help me. Mom?
Barbara, give me your coffee. Let's hang your hands for you.
Mom? Did he make you do it? I would have walked out. That's what I would have did.
Brandon 随后呢被以一级谋杀罪、性暴力和肢解尸体罪被警察逮捕了。一年之后 ，Brandon 尽管当时只有17岁，但是还是被送上了成人的这个法庭。在法庭上，他智力低下的这个问题也被认定跟这个案件无关。最终呢是被判上述的这三项罪名成立，被判无期徒刑，2048年之前不得保释。哎，我不知道大家看完这个审讯之后是什么感觉。但是我可以告诉大家，在美国的司法界啊，这一段审讯可以用一个词来形容，叫做 notorious。臭名昭著。从我个人的角度来说，我真的是觉得极度的不安。几个很明显的点，第一， Brandon 是一个只有16岁的高中生，明显的智力低下。在这种情况之下，警察在审讯室里面审他，竟然没有父母或者律师在场，这是很明显的侵犯他的权利了，这是最大的问题。第二， Brandon 在这次审讯之前至少还被警察问话过四次，尤其是前一次，那天在酒店房间的那一次问话，我们不知道警察到底跟他说了什么，但是从警察刚才审讯室里面说的那些话中间，我们能判断出来 Brandon 呢已经肯定是透露了一些事情了。而前面的几次 Brandon 都没有被逮捕，所以他这一次才会认为啊，今天也不会有什么区别，来跟警察聊一聊之后啊，自己就可以走了，回学校去了。所以警察啊，这是有意无意的实际上给了他一个虚假的保证。不得不说警察的这个战术应用啊是非常聪明的，在很短的时间内啊，你看他审了他这么多次，前几次呢都是问一问就让他走了，使得他放松了警惕啊，他以为真的没事。这一次呢是安排在专门的审讯室里面，还特意的从一开始就骗他，给他这种虚假的保证啊，我们把录音的这个设备关掉了哈，然后抓住这个机会把他审了个底儿掉，直接把 Brandon 一把拍死。第三，审讯的过程呢也是问题很多，我不知道大家感觉到了没有，整个 Brandon 招供的节奏是很奇怪的。一般来说，要不然不说，要不然就是畅所欲言。像他这种挤牙膏一样的招供，本身首先就没有那么常见，就算是有，一般来说他也从最不重要的事情开始承认，然后越说越严重，越说越严重。但是 Brandon 他挤牙膏跟事情的轻重严重与否根本无关，更加像是受到警察的压力和影响之下，这是大脑一团浆糊。尤其中间我着重给大家看了那一段，他很有可能是产生了 false memory， 整个人记忆是混乱的，再加上他本来就被认定是有表达障碍，所以他的这个招供才是这种感觉。第四，他招供的很多内容其实跟事实并不相符。举个例子，他说他们是在 Steven 的这个卧室里面对 Teresa 进行隔喉，但是卧室里既没有发现 Teresa 的血液，也没有发现他的 DNA。 他在审讯中间也有提到他们事后用漂白水和一些底特精啊去清洁过卧室，但是不管是卧室的墙上、地上，还是 Brandon 的衣服、 Steven 的衣服和鞋子上面，都没有发现有使用过化学清洁剂的这个痕迹。他在审讯中提到枪的时候，他是这么说的，是 Teresa 的这个尸体被扔到火里面之后， Steven 拿枪对他开了10枪。而根据后来的调查结果显示， Teresa 是被枪杀于车库中的， 在车库中呢，也发现了子弹的一些碎片，这些碎片上带有 Teresa 的 DNA， 这是一个非常 conclusive， 一个非常难以造假的一个很根本的一个证据，证明 Teresa 至少是在车库里面是中过枪的。第五啊，警察至今为止都没有找到任何一个物证能够证明 Brandon 有参与到杀害 Teresa 的这个案件中间，一个都没有。 Brandon 能够被定罪完全是出于这段审讯他自己说的，换句话说，如果他自己不说，他完全不可能被定罪。在 Brandon 2007年正式入狱之后，他的家人啊、律师团队和一些人权组织从来没有放弃过上诉。在2016年的8月，他们赢得了重大的胜利，美国治安法官 William Stephen 裁定 Brandon 的供词呢是被迫的、非自愿的和违宪的，下令将其释放。但是威斯康星州的司法部门向美国第七巡回上诉法庭提起上诉，法庭下令呢，在判决生效之前呢，是暂时不得释放 Brandon 的。第二年的六月，由第七巡回法庭的三名法官组成的合议庭维持了 Brandon 供词不合法的决定，他们又一次胜利了。但是威斯康星州的司法部门再一次请求第七巡回法庭全部的法官一起来重审。到2017年的年底，第七巡回法庭呢，七名法官一起重审了此案，最终呢是4-3，一票之差推翻了之前的决定，判决警察取得口供的这个行为方式呢是合法的，也就是说 Brandon 这一段证词有效。我知道制造杀人犯的这个纪录片非常火，有很多人相信支持 Brandon 和 Steven 是无罪的，应该把他们释放。但是我不得不说，以我看过的资料来说，我认为至少 Steven 肯定是干了这个事情的，只是确实警察在调查取证过程中间出现了很多的问题。这个案件在咱们这个频道的角度来看，核心其实不是说他们干了没干，而是警察的审讯行为呢要规范要合法，这么做是不行的，是不对的。他们审未成年人，你不能在没有律师没有家人的情况下去审的，尤其是像 Brandon 的这种特殊人群，他们应该确保他一定明白他的米兰达权利和宪法第五修正案的这个权利。甚至于说，对这种特殊人群的审讯，是否应该说警察的手段可以限制一下，不能让他们无限的去使用各种操纵啊、施压、撒谎的这种战术。对于这种人，他太容易被警察影响和统治了。大家是怎么看法的？ Brandon 应不应该被释放？他到底有没有罪呢？咱们评论区里见，一起讨论讨论。好，我是 Eric 长万年，我们下期视频再见了，拜拜。